Hello everyone, welcome back. I'm Lalit Singh. So we're going to continue on our background task lessons only. And today we're going to look at how exactly we can transfer our data more efficiently and one more services in your Android, that is job scheduler. Let's just see what exactly we're going to learn in this session. First, we're going to talk about what are the different ways in which your data can be transferred very efficiently. And then the job scheduler itself. What are the different classes you need inside the job scheduler to schedule your jobs? And how exactly your job scheduler is different than your alarm manager? So let's just talk about how exactly we can transfer the data efficiently first. Well, whenever you transfer the data, it does uses your resources. For example, your wireless radios uses battery. What are wireless radios? Your smartphone comes with plenty amount of wireless radio. Like for your mobile network, there is a wireless wireless radio for your mobile network. There is a wireless radio for your Wi-Fi, that is known as Wi-Fi radio. Same goes with GPS or your Bluetooth. So they drain out your battery. So that's one resources. And of course, if you are downloading some data with your data plans, it costs money to the user. So that's how your wireless radio power states are. Full power, low power, or standby. A wireless radio can stand in three powers. So when it is full power, the network or the connection are active at that point of time, and the highest rate of data transfer is going on. And probably it uses the it uses the battery at its 100% also. Low power, it is at intermediate state and uses 50% less power as compared to your full power. Standby uses the minimal energy and no active network at that point of time. So now let's just see the state transition between these wireless radio states. Well, whenever your wireless radio is at standby mode, it takes 2 second latency to right away get to the full power state. Now, from full power state, if your radio is idle for 5 seconds, it will go to your low power state so that it can save your battery and other resources. And from low power state, if your radio has to again come back to full power state, it will take 1.5 second latency to do that. And if your radio state is not doing for 12 seconds, it's idle for 12 seconds, it will again go back to your standby mode of standby state of your wireless radio. Now, whenever you want to transfer the data, typically in your 3G devices, you do want to bundle your data together. If you try to send each and every data separately, it will take more time, plus it will take more resources. So it's a good practice that you bundle your data together over the network whenever you are sending the data. Okay, now let's just compare between bundle and unbundled data. Well, you can see that you can see the pie chart of both of them. If your data is unbundled, it will be either in high power state or it will be in low power state. It will never be, it's a very less possibility that it will be in your idle state. But if you are transferring your data in a bundle way, yeah, then the high power state, you can see there is a big amount of idle power state also, plus at times it will go to high power state, plus it will be there in low power state. But you can see you can save so much amount of resources and your battery when you are dealing with bundled data transfer. Prefetch data. Now, it is a good practice that you download all your data which you are likely to need for a given period of time in a single burst. Now, if you have guessed right, it will reduce your battery cost and the latency. And if you have guessed wrong, may use more battery and data bandwidth. How do you monitor your connectivity state? For that, we do have a class named Connectivity Manager, which we have already seen in our async task when we connect to the internet. So your Connectivity Manager also manages all your wireless radios also. And it is good practice that you use Wi-Fi radio over your wireless radios as wireless radio consumes more bandwidth. So how exactly you can monitor the battery status? Well, for that we have a battery manager which sends a which broadcasts an intent over the system itself, and the broadcast receiver, which are listening for that particular battery status intent, they will get invoked. That was few ways by which you can transfer your data efficiently. Now let's just talk about the real class which will be used to transfer your data efficiently, that is job scheduler. Now you must be thinking, I have already studied the alarm manager. I have already studied the service. Why I'm studying one more concept to transfer the data? Well, because job scheduler works more efficiently as compared to your alarm manager whenever your timing doesn't really matter. For example, your alarm manager will be precisely working on a particular time. Your job scheduler will be working on certain constraint or conditions. So what exactly a job scheduler is? It's a class which will intelligently schedule all your background tasks based on the condition, not on the time. It is more efficient than your alarm manager, and it was a newly addition added in your API 21. So if you are going to use your job scheduler, you might want to define your minimum SDK as 21 or minimum SDK API as 21. So let's just talk about job scheduler components. What are the different components we need? Well, we need job service, we need job info class, and then we need job scheduler class also. What exactly a job service is? Job service is a class, or to be more precise, you'll be creating a subclass in that, which will be initializing all your tasks. This is where you will put the tasks for your job scheduler. Next class is your job info. It actually is a builder pattern class, which actually builds and sets the condition for your task. Like, you want your tasks to be triggered only when there is a Wi-Fi. Or you want your task to be triggered only when your task is or your device is idle, it's doing nothing. Then we have job schedule class. This class is responsible for scheduling and canceling your task. Plus, it will launch your service too. Let's just talk about job service. So, job service, you are going to create a subclass of your job service. Then you have to override two methods here, known as onStartJob and onStopJob. We're going to talk about both of these methods in a bit, but please be apprised that your job service class runs on your main thread only, just like your services. So if there are any long-running background processes, then you have to, you know, put them in a background worker thread. So what exactly is onStartJob method does? Well, it implements what your work to be done. So this is where you will be putting your work. If it is a work which doesn't take that much time, then you will be returning false. If it is a work which does take too much time, then you have to put them in a different thread, or in a you have to put that work in a background thread, worker thread, and then you have to return true so that my system would know that we have offload heavy work in another thread. This will only initiate, this onStartJob will only get initiated if all the condition which you have defined for your job scheduler are met. It may be until unless your device is not charging, or it may be until unless your device is not connected to Wi-Fi, or it may be all. So you see, it returns a boolean. It will return a false when job is finished. It will return a true when your work has been offloaded to a different thread. And then from that different thread, from that worker thread, you have to call a method job finished. Until unless you do not call job finished, your job service would not know that your job has been finished. So you call that job finished and pass the parameter for your job object inside the job finished. OnStopJob. So what exactly OnStopJob does for you? Well, it will stop or finish your job only if the requirement specified are no longer met. So let's say your downloading or your updation of application was going on because your Wi-Fi was on, but suddenly user is out of Wi-Fi zone, or user turn off the Wi-Fi, then your OnStopJob method is called. So before OnStop, if your job is getting finished, then you need to call job finish and pass the job parameters and the boolean value. The boolean value, the OnStopJob also returns you a boolean value. It will be true if you want to reschedule your job again. Let's say you got cut out from the Wi-Fi, and next time you again come into the Wi-Fi zone, you want to again start that job or reschedule that job, then you will be returning true. Otherwise, if you don't want, you will be returning false. So this is how your basic job service code looks like. There will be your own class. You will be extending with it the job service class, and inside which if your task is going to take long, then you will be putting that in a background thread or a worker thread. And we all know how we can do that by using async task. So you can have an async task class object here, like I'm having here, that is update task. And then you have to override two methods, that is on start job and on stop job. On start job, because it's a long running task, you have to execute your async task. And inside, once your task is executed, your async task is executed, inside the do in background of async task, I will call job finish when it is finished. And as you can see, I'm returning true because I am offloading my work to be a work in a worker thread. Then on stop job, the on stop job will only be called if the requirements are no longer meeting to the requirements which were defined. And I am returning true because I want to reschedule it once the requirement are again met. Defining job service class is not enough. You have to register the job service class inside your manifest file also. Of course, you have to register. It's a service. It's one of the fundamental components of Android. So you have to register that in your Android manifest file. And while you are registering it, you might want to define the permission also. That is android.permission.bindJobService. Now, this is the permission which will be required. If you do not provide this permission, your Android operating system is going to ignore this service as a job service. It will be just like any other service. So your job service will not work. You have to provide permission inside your job service stack. Now let's just talk about job info class. So what exactly job info class is again a class where we will be using a job info dot builder object which will be setting all the condition for executing my task or my job. So how exactly I create the job info dot builder object? Well, I have a job ID object in that, and I have a service component in that. And when I talk about service component, that is the service name. Whatever the service job service class I have, I will provide that job service name in that. And my job info would know that which job service to run. Plus, I have to set the condition also. Now, here are a few conditions. Like you can set the requirement, set the required network type. It may be unmetered, it may be any network type. So accordingly, you can even set the connectivity type for Wi-Fi and all. You can set the idle. Now let's just take a look in each one of these. So set required network type. So in this, you will be telling the system that which type of network to be present while you start or while you schedule your job. It can be any, it can be on not on roaming, or it can be unmetered. Set backoff criteria is how soon you can reschedule your task. First parameter will tell you the initial time to wait before your task fails. And the second parameter will tell you how long you have to wait subsequently. Set minimum latency condition will set the condition for minimum wait before your task gets complete. Set override deadline is the condition which will define the maximum wait time before you start running your task, even if other conditions aren't met. Set periodic condition is actually a mutually exclusive condition with your minimum latency and your override deadline condition. So it will repeat task after a certain amount of time. You have to provide that interval for after what interval you want to repeat that task. It is not guaranteed that the task will run on that particular time only. It might be the case that after 60 minutes it will run, but not at the exact 60 minutes. It may run at 62 or 63 minutes, but it will never run before 60 minutes. Set persisted condition will be used to set whether the job is to be persisted even if the system reboots. So put true if you want it, put false if you don't want it. if you are putting true, then you might want to include the permission for receive boot completes, and then you have to schedule or save the data accordingly. Set required charging will set the condition that whether your device requires charging while you are scheduling your job or not. You can put true or false. By default, it's false. Set requires device idle condition. You want to set when your device is in idle mode. So you want to set those tasks here which requires heavy resources. So by default, it's false. But you can put true that only when your device is idle, you want to schedule your job. So this is a small code snippet how exactly your job info.builder object will look like. It will have a job ID. It will be an integer value. It will have the component, the name of the service which you want to execute, and the few conditions. Please be apprised, if you do not put any condition, your job info.builder object will not be accepted. It will give you an error. And after that, after you have the job info.builder object, then you just have to build and you get the job info object. Now let's just talk about job scheduler class. Now before we schedule our job, I need to get the access of the job scheduler object first. How can I do that? For that, I need to use get system service. And inside that, I will be using the constant job scheduler service, job underscore scheduler underscore service. And this will give me the access of job scheduler object. And then I will just call schedule method, and inside which I will provide my job info object, which I have already built. And once I do that, my job will be scheduled according to the condition, until and unless condition are not met, the job will not be getting triggered, but the job is already scheduled there. To learn more about job scheduler, job services, and job info classes, you can follow the following links. Next, we're going to see the concept and the practical part in our Git book, and we are also going to see a small demo on job scheduler. Thank you.